see this? It's coral from the Red Sea. There's quite a bit of it down below there on the seabed. But we're here for something more interesting than coral. This British Admiralty chart indicates there's an underwater bridge here across from Nuweiba on the Egyptian side to Arabia. And we've been diving across here. This is our diving map. We've marked our underwater bridge and it deepens off both sides, but we're about to take you on a journey to the bottom of the sea. Friends, do we have something exciting for you now? Welcome back. The desert pushed right down to the water's edge. And as Syed, our Egyptian friend, packed the sleeping gear back onto the roof rack, Paul stood there watching the sunrise over the sea. If we were not mistaken, there was something quite startling down there on the floor of the Red Sea. Well, we got ready to check it out. Gilly, Aviv of Israel, myself, Paul Springall of London, the Egyptian Syed, a Bedouin kid or two. This whole story, in fact, begins much, much earlier in that land of romance and mystery, ancient Egypt. There are clues that in the 3rd millennium BC, Egypt sprang up suddenly, fully developed, with a fantastic ready-made civilization. Great cities, enormous temples, pyramids of overwhelming size. In fact, if you look carefully, you'll see a man, a little man just right there at the bottom. This is a construction which is 48 stories high. Enormous buildings, overwhelming, and colossal statues with tremendous expressive power. Egypt was a land of great achievement. In fact, we have already mentioned in the Dead Men's Secrets segment that if you were to put a line through the Great Pyramid of Egypt, horizontally and vertically, you would have a point on the globe in which you could measure the land surface of the earth equally in each of those four sections. It seems that the builders were well aware of the exact amount of land on the surface of the earth, as well as the geographical distribution. Now, a natural question comes to people here in Australia. Could they have known of Australia? Friends, away back there in the time of the pharaohs, there was a cut through from the Mediterranean Sea to the Red Sea. There was a canal. In fact, satellite technology and infrared photography show the paths of three canals cutting through there. So the French were not the first to do this. And it would only be a matter of quite easy travelling for them to come across to this section of the world. Aborigines of the Kimberleys of northwestern Australia greeted the first white men with ancient secret Masonic hand signs. They also had customs, religious features and words clearly of Egyptian origin, as well as blood groups and racial features from the Middle East. A few years ago in the Blue Mountains of New South Wales, mysterious figures were discovered which are totally unlike known in the Aboriginal style of art in the region. These are more reminiscent of Egyptian deities from the ancient world associated with sun worship. One of them resembles the moon goddess Isis, and this one resembles the sun god Osiris. And you take off the sun disk from his head and you have a distinctly Egyptian appearance. This is probably about 3,000 years old. Near Gordonvale, Queensland, in 1910, at the base of the Pyramid Mountains, in 2 metres of soil, this scarab was found with detailed Egyptian hieroglyphics. Such scarabs were often inserted into the heart cavities of Egyptian mummies. Chemical analysis of some Egyptian mummies has revealed the presence of Australian eucalyptus oil. indicating contact with Australia in the days of the pharaohs. This teenage girl, by the way, lost her lower legs before death, perhaps to a crocodile bite, but had been given false ones, artificial legs, to walk around on. The Egyptian explorer Kim Hotep returned with a wild report of a vast continent where animals carried their young in pouches and the natives threw a weapon that came back to the hand. Egypt was the superpower of that age. You might say that in relation to other nations of her time, she was where the United States is today in relation to our present world. However, high civilization does not guarantee good social conditions. We have a slaved race here living in the Nile Delta of Egypt, now in ancient times called the land of Ramesses or the land of Goshen, was the Hebrew race. They had been granted this area by a previous pharaoh, and then there arose a new dynasty which did not recognize these ethnics and decided that the only way to treat them was to enslave them. And so we have the history of a sophisticated nation enslaving some of its people. The pharaoh became very disturbed as the population of the Hebrews continued to increase despite the oppression. And so he resorted to a most extreme measure. And this was to decree the death of the newborn baby boys of the Hebrews. There was born a slave's baby who was now to bring Egypt down. One mother determined that her baby would not die. She fashioned a little basket lined with pitch and gave it to her daughter to place in the pharaoh's vicinity where the palace was beside the Nile River. And when the princess came down to wash, she discovered this little Hebrew baby in the basket. In the love of her heart, she adopted this little boy. And secretly he grew up as a prince in the house of his mother. Here we have a mortuary temple built in honor of this woman, we believe, who adopted the baby Moses. And this is across the Nile River on the western side, upstream. This temple, we believe, was built by the adopted son. And behind it, there is a tomb with an unfinished statue of this young boy with his mother, after the Egyptian style. Down in the Cairo Museum, there are four great statues as you walk from one chamber into another, all of which are claimed to be statues of Ramesses II. But the interesting thing about this, friends, is that when you compare these four statues, they are of four different people. They all have different faces. And if you look at this one up close now, you'll notice that he does not have an Egyptian face. It's a distinctly Hebrew face. Notice the nose. As Moses grew, he went through the slave fields. And he began to realize that his own people, his blood relatives, were being oppressed. And here was Moses planning to be king of Egypt one day. There in the palace of Egypt, he came to the point of decision. One day he was driving through the area where the slaves were being oppressed. He saw an Egyptian fighting with a Hebrew. And in a fit of rage, Moses struck the Egyptian. The Egyptian died. Soon after that, Moses realized he had been observed, and he knew that he could no longer stay in Egypt. He had to leave the country. There is a tomb. It's known as Tomb 353. It's an unfinished tomb. You'll notice here that the paintings have been done and etched in. But when it comes to the lower portion here, only the black ink has been put in place and no carving has been done. In this tomb, there are names which suggest to us that Moses himself was the person for whom this tomb was being fashioned as future king. and that when he left Egypt, all work stopped. No one ever used this tomb.